And so now about a few words about specific features, so about this normalized detention time. I think you already have seen a presentation about IRT, but I hope it's not too repetitive, but I still want to show you this very quickly. So IRT, you can, let's talk about the way forward. So you would have two standard peptides, this one and this one, the red ones, and you define the value for those two peptides, and you measure on a linear gradient a third peptide, this one here. And if you have a sign in IRT for this one and this one, and you have a linear gradient, you can also calculate an IRT for the peptide in the middle, so for this one. It's a simple linear equation. You can get an IRT for a third peptide by fixing just two fixed points. You can also imagine the Celsius scale, it was fixed at 0 and 100, which is water that is ice and boiling water, just two points were fixed, it's the same concept basically. And then you can also go the way back, so once you have your IRT values, and you have measured the two fixed points on a new chromatographic setup, you can predict the retention time of this peptide independent of the gradient, or gradient length, or the gradient used, or whatever. So it goes in both directions. And we also defined this set of 11 IRT peptides, two of those peptides, this one here and this one here, these were the fixed points, it was defined as 0 and 100. Now you could ask, why didn't we take the first one? We didn't take the first one because it showed more fluctuation than the second one, because usually how the gradients are set up, in the beginning, in the very beginning, you have more fluctuation. That's why we chose the second one. And so these are 11 non-naturally occurring stable peptides. They're evenly spread over RT range, and two peptides were used as fixed points. And now how can you use that? In the beginning, we used it a lot for scheduled MRAM, because if you schedule, you can measure more peptides. And you can use the same concept for QRAM, of course. But you can also use it for target extraction for DIA data. And so this is what we started to use it right afterwards and implemented it into spectral mode. So let's imagine you generate a spectral library, let's say with spectral mode. If you have your IRT peptides in your sample, you can determine IRTs for all the tens of thousands of peptides you have measured in Shotgun. And spectral mode can do this automatically. So if you generate a spectral library, all the peptides measured have an IRT assigned to them. And now what happens if you measure all the peptides again on a gradient and you plot the RT versus IRT? If you have a linear gradient, basically it shows you just a straight line. If you use a nonlinear gradient, then it looks like that. So you can basically predict the retention time of all the peptides in your gradient. And you can also see if in your LC, for instance, something is crooked. If you have a hiccup somewhere, you can immediately see it in this visualization. Now how do you use that for target analysis? So yeah, it's very simple. If you have a full expected ion chromatogram, you can just zoom into your full expected ion chromatogram and actually only look in the region where you expect the peptide. And this would be the zoom in here, so you only look in this region and you do the peak detection only in this region. Of course, you choose the window in a way that you would never miss the peptide, or let's say almost never miss the peptide. Then you can also check what happens if you have no IRT in your spectral library, what happens if you have IRT, or what happens if you have very precise IRT in your library, and this is what we have done for a postulate SMS here in 2014. And we looked just at the identifications you get. You can see that you get more IDs if you have a very precise IRT, but also that your identifications get more reproducible. So the same peptides are more reproducibly identified. The better your IRTs are, in general, the better your spectral library is. So that's something you would expect. Okay, now a few words about FDR estimation. My first presentation I gave here at the SRM course was only about that, and I think it was people didn't find it so interesting, so I kept it to a relative minimum here. So the basic approach is, although as I said, it's borrowed from MRAM data, so we developed this initially for MRAM data, and the idea is that you would simulate truly absent peptide signals. It's also done in Shotgun proteomics with your reverse FASTA file. And after that, you can use a method of story to estimate Q values, and these are a number of figures from this MRAM publication, mProfit here. And what you can see here is the score distribution for targets and decoys, so for true and false signals in this case, for the subscores that we developed for mProfit. So here are 8 subscores. In black, you can see the distribution of the decoys, and in gray, you can see the distribution of the signals. We knew that they were true. And you can also look at this at the final discriminant score. This is a combination of all the scores here. So you can see here it's a bit different. You can see the true signals here. So these are the present peptides, and these here are the absent peptides. And the red ones are the decoys. They simulate the absent peptides, basically. And so we use this concept also to check the FDR estimates of spectral mode in a little bit different way. So the idea was we wanted to see whether the decoys are really truly, so they are a fair representation of absent peptides, because, quickly go back, if this red distribution would be completely off, for instance, if it would be over here, your FDR estimates would be terribly wrong. So you want to check that this distribution here overlaps with the gray distribution below here. And that's what we did. So we want to simulate truly absent peptides, and for this we took assays from an organism different to the one analyzed. So we analyzed human sample, we mixed the spectral library with assays from E. coli. This depicted here. So we made a spectral library for human, we made a spectral library for E. coli, we mixed the two spectral libraries. We only took high abundant peptides here, so only the ones we are more certain to be able to see. We analyzed the human sample with spectral with a mixed spectral library, and the result looks like that, so as you would expect, or how it's supposed to be. So the E. coli assays, we couldn't detect.